So today I wanted to spend some time in clearing any doubts about the submission and evaluation detail of the projects. I will recite the important dates in the remaining evaluation schedule, and then we'll briefly discuss the end semester examination syllabus and the structure of the end sem paper. Since this is the last lecture of the course, I'll offer some concluding remarks and we'll close it. I had mentioned these things earlier, but this is more of a recapitulation. This is your final project report. So this must include the copy of the document of the stage one report. You would have submitted it earlier, but there were many students who said that they would have liked to improve it and so on, and they might have made a subsequent submission. But the reports that have been evaluated are on the basis of whatever you submitted on the scheduled date. So if you wish to report that you have made some modifications, and this may happen, by the way, with all projects. When you start up, you think of something, but you refine your thinking as you go ahead. And when you complete the project, you might have a much better and clearer idea and focus of what exactly should have been stated as the main object. It is possible that you might want to revamp part of your stage one report. So this is perfectly fine. The copy of the document of stage one report, I will say, so stage one report modified if necessary. Obviously, it should not include all the sample code that you might have written or any other subdirectories or any such thing. Only the main report that you had submitted in stage one. If you wish to modify, then modified version, in which case you should state that this is modified version so that it will be read proper. Otherwise, if you just include it, it will be assumed that you are going ahead, you have gone ahead with whatever you had stated earlier. Then it should contain your main report. So brief description of various modules and programs that you have written. Status of completion. It is not necessary that every team would have succeeded in completing all the targets that one had started with. After all, it's a limited time course project. It's not a full-time activity for any one of you. So that is perfectly possible and acceptable. There's no problem about it. But you should state as to which programs have been completely tested, which are not yet working fully, or which have yet to be written. And all this should be in the context of whatever you set out to do. Very important, as you know, we started off with these projects as open-ended projects. So it is nobody's case that whatever you decided to do was the only thing that could be done for that project. If you had infinite time, for example, if you had one more year to complete the project, you would perhaps think of many additional things that you would like to do. So it is not whether you would like to do it or not, but the ideas that you get for future extension of the project should be included as a specific paragraph saying ideas for future work. Then there should be a very brief description of individual contributions, specifically the actual work done by each individual member of the team. So if your project has, say, for example, 10 programs, then who wrote which programs, who contributed to ideas in which program, who designed the algorithms, who did the documentation, who did the testing. So for each student member of the team, you should very briefly, two or three lines only, should state what work was done by that student. So that will tell me the nature of the work. Of course, the amount of time spent will come out in individual diaries, which I will be describing. As usual, there should be a single tar file. This time it should say lab underscore batch, that is 432, 721, 561, whatever. Followed by, I'm sorry, there should have been a there should be a underscore here. It should contain the word final underscore report so that we can distinguish it. We'll be combining your stage one and this report together. So this word final report is important because the same batch number will be there for the first stage star file also. It should contain, as usual the last time, all the subdirectories that you might have. For example, you might have a subdirectory for program, subdirectory for documentation, subdirectory for test data. Depending on how you have organized, all those subdirectories should be put together in the tar. The date for submission, at least some of you would have read the mail which I had sent yesterday evening. Right. So the date for submission is extended. This is because many people pointed out that some have their last lab today, that is Friday, and important discussions and finalizations could take place today. And it would be unreasonable that the lab ends at 10 o'clock and 12 midnight is the submission time. So therefore, we thought about it and decided that we'll extend the submission time, but not to midnight, to 9 o'clock on Saturday. So please remember it is 9 p.m. We will be having special lab sessions instead of Sunday, which we usually used to have. We'll have these on Saturday. So Saturday 2 to 4 and 4 to 6. But no other work is expected to be done except consolidating your project report and uploading your files. That is the objective. Some of you can upload it from your own laptops or connecting any other way to Moodle. That is also perfectly fine. But in any case, it should be done before 9 o'clock. I'll tell you the reason why I'm not putting this as midnight, and that is because I need to personally read at least the description of the work done by individuals and the diary consolidated entries, which I'll describe in a moment, in order to select sample students from every batch for Viva, which is scheduled on Sunday. Now, I should have some finite time at my disposal to read it. If the last time is midnight, then I will have barely about 4 or 5 hours. And you will agree that isolating 70 reports and reading them and making up the mind, and also I would like to catch at least 1 or 2 hours of sleep if possible. You would not like me sleeping during the Viva, right? Actually, you would like it. Yeah. But I would not like it. I would like to be awake when I conduct the Viva. So these, you can pre-register for these labs. There is a pre-registration link and you can register. I would suggest that a large number of students should not come up. Typically, 1 or 2 members from each team should register, either from 2 to 4 or from 4 to 6 and finish off the work. Those of you who have completed your programming and can consolidate and upload the reports from your own laptops or from your own hostels, you're most welcome to do so. This is merely an additional facility. But 9 o'clock tomorrow is the deadline. As I mentioned, sample Viva sessions are planned on Sunday. Unfortunately, since I can't select people, I can't put up the list of selected people before I have selected them. So that is why I will send a mail and put up the schedule on the Moodle by 6 o'clock on Sunday morning. I hope to finish my own evaluation by that time. So 6 o'clock Sunday morning, a mail will be sent from me giving you a file containing the names of the students and the schedule. You don't have to wait for the whole day for that Viva because the Viva will go on for the whole day, but I will allocate schedule on an hourly basis. So it will be, for example, when we start from 9 o'clock onwards, 9 to 10, 10 to 11, 11 to 12, 12 to 1 are the morning hours, and 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5 are the afternoon hours. I am told that some students might have an NSEM exam on that day for some lab or something, or some Viva. Such students should immediately send a mail, and I will reschedule their Viva in the evening on Sunday from 5 to 6 slot. So that slot 5 to 6 is a special slot for such people. It is not, this is a sample Viva, sample schedule. If I get convinced that the marks allocated on the peer review basis are reasonable, I may not sample anybody from a team. In some cases, I may sample two or more students from a team. That is what sampling is all about. Okay? Now, this is what is important. As I said earlier, you might never have given marks to yourselves, and you might not have ever defended such marks to a group of colleagues. In my opinion, this activity itself is very important and should teach you a whole lot of things. In particular, when you become professionals later, you would be perpetually evaluating yourself. At most, a manager of yours might be evaluating you. So unless you learn to evaluate yourself correctly, you would have difficulties later. This is one exercise in doing that. It has nothing to do with programming. It has to do with judging yourself reasonably accurately relative to a group of people with whom you are working. So I repeat this here. The marks are to be allocated by each one by finding out the qualitative and quantitative contribution made to the project. Quantitative contribution is not very difficult to measure because it is quantitative. In general, I can work out totally how many hours and minutes I have spent on the project, could be for different activities. If I have written programs, how many lines of code I have been able to write. If I have written documentation, how many pages of documentation I have been able to write. If I have done testing, how much of testing I have done. If I have spent time in discussion of ideas, how much time I have spent, I should be able to get that time from the diary entry. I would know that. Qualitative contribution has to be judged by each individual. Because since I am working in a team, I would know roughly what everybody has done. Within the job that was allocated to me, how much of quality work I have been able to put, how much of correct things I have been able to do, how much of my mind I have applied. Now, this is a judgment, and these judgments may differ from people to people. That's the reason why the marks are not finalized by an individual. Although initially I will say I deserve so many marks. Here are some guidelines. The maximum contribution should typically get 9 or 10 marks. Average contribution should get 6 or 8 marks. I will clarify this a little bit more because I had an instance where a team, this happened not last year but year before last, a team claimed that everybody contributed equally and gave 10 marks to everyone. Now, if everybody had contributed equally, then the contribution is average. And that should deserve 6 to 8 marks. So they almost lost 3 marks during the Viva when they were told that you can't get 10, everybody will get 3. Then the coordinator who was accompanying that student said, "Sir, permit us to revamp our thing. We'll have a meeting quickly and we'll decide." Because it is obvious that in any group of 6, 7, 8 people, everybody is doing exactly the same amount of qualitative and quantitative contribution is unlikely. Some people would have done more work, some people would have done less work. In particular, there could be some absolute sleeping members in your team. If they exist, then they must be given 0 marks. If they are not given 0 marks, and because they are your friends, and I value friendship as much as you do, but a real friendship must say, look, you have earned, and you have no business claiming more marks because that might jeopardize the whole batch. In such cases, obviously every member of the batch may suffer if that person is selected. Suppose you give such a person 3 marks or 4 marks saying that we have done little work, but actually it turns out that the student has done no work at all. Then every member of the team will lose 3 marks out of it. So please remember to be very, very careful with these markings. The general process is that everybody forms an idea of the marks that I should get and we should have a quick meeting. Ordinarily, this meeting would not take more than 15 to 20 minutes. If you already conducted such meeting, that is fine. If you have not, please conduct it. Today is your last time, at most tomorrow morning. There must be a formal meeting. The meeting minutes should be recorded That means on plain paper, you should write the roll numbers and names of everybody. You should say, we met at this date, this time, and the marks finalized were this. This is what you will copy. But the hard copy evidence signed by the coordinator on the day of the meeting has to be produced at the time of viva. So that is necessary. I hope you agree that when you have an authority to give marks to yourselves, you must have appropriate accountability to justify whatever you do. So is this clear? Let me mention this very specifically, because I am going to put this on the Moodle. I suspect that most of you would not have conducted such meetings so far. This is your time. If you have done it, you can construct the minutes of the meeting by writing them on one page. Coordinator should sign that. And this page must be brought to the viva from the person who is selected. In case in some teams I don't select anybody, the coordinator would be requested to submit this and other material which I will be elaborating now. So this is required for the Sunday one. This need not be a very elaborate write-up or something. The minutes would say that we met and discussed these marks. If there has been any strong observations by someone, for example, there could be a dispute, you could write one line that such and such person disputed the marks being given. However, this was our opinion. In such cases, you can also write the marks of what that student claims and the marks that were finally allocated after PRE. Okay. That is the purpose of the minutes. You basically record all the discussion that takes place. But it need not be a very elaborative, formal affair. Just one page will be sufficient. Now the marks that you write by hand on this are to be, of course, consolidated and submitted as part of your report, which has to be entered in soft copy. All of you must be keeping hard copies of the diaries. These are important because all these will be evaluated individually. I had said that I need a consolidated diary report for the entire project team. I have suggested a format which I am trying to elaborate here. For example, you can say consolidated diary, put these columns, discussions, design, programming, testing, documentation, and miscellaneous. Miscellaneous could be any other activity which is not so classic. So for example, some student here might have spent 2 hours 30 minutes in discussions, may not have participated in designing, may have spent 4 hours 50 minutes in programming, may have spent 3 hours in designing, etc., etc. So these entries are to be consolidated. How will you consolidate these? Each individual student is maintaining the hard copy of the personal diary. From that personal diary, you can ask each student only to compile this information. But the coordinator should cross-check with that physical diary that yes, there is no addition mistake or something. I have seen that addition mistakes on the positive side occur very frequently in such consolidated diaries. So that should not happen, because if on a cross-check that is found, that will be tantamount to cheating. And the whole batch may suffer because of that. I will not hesitate incidentally in giving 0 marks for the entire team, for the entire project, if I suspect that ethical practices have been chewed up. That is not acceptable in this course, as you know. Everything else is okay. So this is how you will consolidate these. So again, to recapitulate, every student should consolidate from one's own physical diary entries the total number of hours and minutes. This is not fractional hours, by the way. So don't write 4.52 hours. 4 hours colon so many minutes. That's the idea. And every student should consolidate such time under these categories, bring it together. This consolidation, by the way, can also be done during your final meeting. Because when you meet, everybody should bring the diaries. These diaries need to be collected by the coordinator necessarily, as I'll explain. The paper copies of the project diary maintained by each student should be collected physically. These are to be brought to the Viva session by the student selected for the Viva from that batch. Typically, I would expect a student selected for the Viva should be accompanied by the one of the coordinators. If the coordinator is unable to come, then any one active member of the team who is aware of the jobs that were allocated to different students and the work that was done. I will tell you why it is necessary. Many times, the student who is selected for the Viva may happen to be one of the weaker students in the batch. Now, weaker students, apart from doing relatively less contribution, often turn out to be very shy students and students who cannot speak well. Now, what happens that during the Viva, if the student is not able to defend, because essentially what is that Viva about? I am trying to claim that the student has not done as much as the student claims, and student has to refute this. So in short, the team coordinator or any other active member will work as what you may call defense lawyer for that student. That coordinator has to help that student defend himself or herself that yes, this work has been done, this is the explanation, whatever. So that is why it is useful. It is also an important exercise, should do that. Ordinarily, this Viva would be over in 2 minutes, because if we figure out, there will be a pipeline process, incidentally. Two of my colleagues will be sitting in the class. These Vivas will be conducted on Sunday in room number 304 and 305 of the Crescent building. I will put up the schedule and this thing. All students are to assemble in a lecture hall on the third floor. There will be my staff there who will guide you. So the students who come for that 1 hour slot and the other students who come for the next hour should all assemble there. They will be called batch-wise, as they are called. In fact, you can guess the schedule. The schedule will be as per the batch days, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 6 hours, 4 hours in the morning. For the first hour, we will have slot one, the batches starting with 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. And there may be some movement because of the scheduling, but this will be roughly the thing. So students who come for Viva and their colleague coordinators or other active members will sit in that classroom. They will be called. Usually, the pipeline process will be, they will be first called by a team which will collect all your diaries and examine the consolidated diary entry and compare the particular entry of that student. Okay. If they are convinced that things are okay, you will only have a brief meeting with me for 1 minute, and after which I will say you can go. If they are not convinced, then the Viva may extend up to even 10 minutes or 15 minutes. Okay, so these two, this is the process that we will finish on. While I mentioned that it is quite likely that I will call weak students to examine this, it is not necessary. For example, if I notice that two students have been given 10 marks each, then I might call one of them to convince myself that the student indeed deserves to have 10 marks. It may so happen that the student himself or herself is the coordinator, which is okay. In which case, that student should bring all the physical diary. But it is a must. Now, some people would have written these diary entries on a notebook. So I don't want notebooks to be submitted. What I want is the corresponding papers of the diary entry should be removed, should be stapled together for each student. Roll number should be written, of course. And for all 7 students, this collection of pages should be brought. Okay. Because this is the physical diary against which I will, or my staff will verify that the consolidated entries make sense. So is this clear? You may ask me as to why I am going through so much of fuss for 10 marks, which will ultimately get reduced to 5 marks because of the compression. But please note that this is the first time and probably the last time even in IIT, you would be doing a self-evaluation. Ordinarily, marks are given by others. You only give answers. So it is important that you understand the process of evaluation, the seriousness of that evaluation, and comply with it. I hope you agree with this process. Fine. The schedule of remaining examinations, Project Viva for selected students, Sunday, 13th November, end semester examination, Thursday, 24th November. I am putting up the re-exam schedule. There is already one student who has broken his hand or something and has been advised bed rest for 4 days, 4 weeks. So he has already given a medical certificate and said he won't be able to attend the NSAM exam now. So for him, the NSAM exam has to be the re-exam. Usually the re-exam is in the month of December. This year the Senate has resolved that all re-examinations must be completed and the grades submitted to academic office by 21st of December. So I am trying to keep this date as close to 21st as possible, and that is why this is Saturday the 17th November. Why I mention this date to this class is that in spite of your best efforts and in spite of my best efforts, there might still be some students who may not pass in this course. This has rarely happened in my courses, but every year there are one or two or three people who work so hard that all my efforts are useless. They still fail. In this particular batch, the number of such hardworking students appears to be more. So that is the reason why I stopped doing any additional things in this course and concentrated on the revision. If per chance it so happens that someone is not able to clear the course in the first attempt, there will be an exam on 17th. And although I have not written it here, I will announce it after the grades are declared. I propose to run a special boot camp for 1 week for such students from after the declaration of results, that is around 4th of December to about 15th of December on some appointed. So in case that becomes essential, I hope it does not become essential for any one of you. But these are the dates that you should keep in. Yeah, any question? Oh, I can't have a re-exam before the main exam, right? Very good point. Thank you so much. That would be a very anticipatory re-examination. December 17, 2000. Thanks for pointing that out. Okay. This is the evaluation schedule. The assignments, including the makeup assignments, have been evaluated. Unfortunately, my TAs could submit the assignment marks only yesterday. I had given them a deadline till yesterday evening, 6 o'clock. Did you get all of them? Okay. Good news from my staff. Out of 74 TAs, about 40 TAs have not yet submitted the marks. So they were supposed to submit the stage 1 marks and the assignment marks. There are some TAs who told me that they are still waiting for some of their students to complete the assignments because I had asked them to give makeup assignments. You can see that one student can delay the processing for the entire batch because of this. Okay. Anyway, I will now again send a mail to them saying, please submit whatever marks you have got and the stage 1 marks. Hopefully, I'll get them by tonight. So I should be able to upload them by Sunday morning. Should be able to look those. The updated mid-sem and updated quiz marks have already been loaded. Project stage 1 and assignment marks will be loaded very shortly. I presume that the evaluation has been completed in the majority of cases. Wherever it remains, we'll do that. Why I emphasize this point? Ordinarily, all the in-semester marks should be known to you before you approach the NSAM. Unfortunately, because of the long Diwali week, it was not really a week, long Diwali, 10 days, holidays, the whole timetable has been reshuffled. As you know, the project stage 2 should have been completed and the marks would have been already allocated by this time. Since this has not happened, there has been some delay. Accordingly, the consolidation of all marks cannot happen till Sunday night. Okay. Technically, the last day of instructions for the institute is Monday the 14th. Although we don't have a lecture on 14th. We will ensure that all marks in their final form for the in-semester evaluation, except project stage 2, are put up on the Moodle so that you can cross-check. In any case, you should keep cross-checking your marks because that spreadsheet in a PDF form will be kept there. Okay. In case of any discrepancy, I would expect to receive a mail as quickly as possible so that it can be corrected. The last chance for anybody to cross-check and request for correction would be the exam time, because that is the time when we will all be meeting. But let us not delay it up to that point. Let us complete this portion earlier. The project stage 2, the evaluation schedule ends on 21st November 2011. There is a reason for this. I have decided to evaluate project stage 2 myself for all projects. Unfortunately, I am going to US on next week sometime. But fortunately, in the United States, people don't work in the nights. So I will have a lot of free nights, about 3 free nights. I should be able to read all the project reports and give marks out of 50. This evaluation can be completed, plus the 2 long flights to US and back. So this will be completed by 21st midnight. 21st midnight, I will be putting up the marks for the final stage. This will, of course, include your marks for project as well as marks for the Viva or the self-evaluation marks moderated by Viva. NSEM paper evaluation is scheduled on 28th November. That is because the TAs are not free otherwise. The scrutiny of evaluated answer books can be done on 29th and 30th. I'll put up a schedule for the scrutiny. Those people who want to come, they will not be distributed papers. There will be my staff there. You can examine your papers. And as usual, if you have any observations, you'll be given blank pages on which you can write your observations. On first, we will probably assemble a set of TAs available to look at those complaints and reevaluate if necessary. There is a group of students, first year chemistry, they're not here. Are they in this slot? No, they are in slot 11, I think. They are going for a 1-week camp in IISc Bangalore. So they are coming back on 1st of night. For them only, on 2nd December morning, we'll have the scrutiny period. There are only about 25 or so students. So in case one or two of them have some observations, we'll finish off the correction. And the final grades will be put up on 2nd December afternoon. That is also the time when the grades will be submitted online. So after I put them up, I usually give myself and the students a cooling period of about 12 hours. So since these will be displayed, I will call them draft grades. They'll be displayed on Moodle as also on the course page. So even if you have gone away, either you or you can ask a friend of yours to cross-check the grade. If there is any last-minute serious complaint that, for example, the total marks are not exactly as you think they should be, then you can even then send an email quickly. I'll personally look into that. The final grades will be submitted on 3rd, which is just one day prior to the last date. Re-exam paper evaluation will be on 17th itself because I don't expect, there is one student guaranteed to be there. I don't expect more than 2, 3, 4, whatever, small number. We'll complete the evaluation on the same day and keep the scrutiny for re-exam papers on 18th December. This time it is December and not November, so I'm right. Now we come to the most important part, the NSEM syllabus. As I mentioned, this time I increase the pace slightly after covering the basic concepts. And many students have mentioned to me that they were unable to cope up with that increased pace. As a result, they were unable to understand even the detailed discussion on things like pointers, structures, and files. While they were coping up with those, and while they were trying to solve those problems, we started discussing classes. We also started discussing problems which use class functions and so on. And they say that they have not been able to understand much of it. Now that the NSEM exam is approaching here, we don't have much time, and therefore I have decided that class as a syllabus portion will not be included in the final exam. So you don't have to worry about learning how to define member functions, how to use them, how to define constructors, destructors, whatever, whatever. That is not part of the questioning report. However, there would be some of you who would have mastered the art of using classes. While solving programming problems which are given, if you so wish, you are most welcome to use classes, including the standard C++ class libraries. There is absolutely no problem in that. However, it is not obligatory to do so. At least there won't be any question which will say, define a class for doing this or something like that. Okay. There would be programming problems which could be solved using the conventional program. You don't need to use it. Is that okay? Now the structure of the NSEM paper. I have put a question mark to that structure. So I want your opinion. How many questions? Easy, difficult? Multiple choice questions in a final exam. That's very interesting. Fill in the blanks, that's another thing. Now, let's discuss this seriously. One observation that most students have made is that my papers have been rather lengthy. They are not necessarily lengthy to solve, but they are lengthy to understand. So you spend a lot of time in reading the question, understanding it, and by the time you have understood, the clock has gone ahead. So, if you feel such things about my paper, how will you solve real problems in life? People will always describe their problems in very long-handed way. You might have to read a file containing 200 pages which describes a situation. And you have to give a decision tomorrow morning. You have to read and understand those 200 pages. It has nothing to do with programming. In programming context, if you are a professional, you might be given a code spanning 1,000 lines. And you are supposed to understand it, correct the mistakes, and make the corrected program run before the sun rises tomorrow morning. These are hard problems in life that you will be facing. So reading and understanding a question is important, should be done as quickly as possible. However, I do admit that during the exam stress, long questions do take time to read. Now, I cannot change my questioning style. The programming problems that I will ask you to solve will necessarily relate to some realistic situation. Barring problems which will involve, let us say, summation of series, or handling a two-dimensional array containing some image pixels, etc., where the description could be short. If at all I am describing a problem which needs use of files, then I will have to describe the file format of the data. If the data pertains to a situation which has not been discussed in the class earlier, that situation will have to be described. In short, the way you handle your projects, for example, where in the project, if you have any information management requirement, you will spend at least 2 pages describing that requirement. So there is no shortcut to that. Instead, what I have thought is that there will be some questions, particularly the file handling questions. Suppose I ask you to solve a problem which uses a binary file containing data which can be directly accessed and updated. The program writing may not be very difficult, but to understand what is to be done may not be easy. So it will take some time. So what I'll do is, ordinarily you have large number of questions in a, you had a quiz paper and even the mid-sem paper. I will reduce the total number of questions, and I will ensure that the paper can definitely be solved in 2 hours 30 minutes by people who can spend reasonable time in understanding and programming. Those who will take slightly longer will have an additional 30 minutes. Is that all right with you? Fine. So this time, since we have time, we will be setting up the questions, but I will be asking some of my own people to solve those problems under oath of secrecy, of course. And I will note how long they take to understand the problem and solve it. That is when we will be able to come to a judgment. So let us come back to the structure here. There would in all be about 6 questions. That is because you have a 3-hour paper. But it does not mean that you will have half an hour per question. You would still be required to solve some questions in 10 to 15 minutes. This time I'll make sure that the questions are graded from simple to difficult in that question paper. So you don't have to unnecessarily scan the whole paper to find out which one is simple. The simplicity is not necessarily in solution. Sometimes the understanding the question may be the more difficult part, and you may have to spend more time doing that, after which writing the program may turn out to be simple, which is okay. At least one question will not be a multiple choice question, but it will have about 5 to 8 parts. Of 1 mark each. I hope you have seen the pattern of the makeup quiz which has been put up on the Moodle. The makeup quiz part 1 was essentially a multiple choice paper. This was a multiple choice questions because A, B, C, D, and E answers that were given were to be self-evaluated. Here there is no self-evaluation, so you are unlikely to have A, B, C, D, E choices. Instead, you will be asked to write what exactly would be the output of that program, or you would be asked to write some additional statements in that program. So it will be these 5 to 8 parts will examine whether you have understood simple concepts of expression evaluation, integer, floating point, etc., whether you have understood simple concepts of conditional execution, if then else, if else if, okay, or the switch statement, etc., whether you have understood the implications of different iterative control structures such as for, while, do while. So there will be small, short program segments. Invariably, you will have to execute those program segments to figure out what is to be done. If there are expressions, you might have to write C++ expressions. These will be the simple questions. These will amount to about 8 marks. So I've said 5 to 8. There may be some parts which have 2 marks. There's some parts which have 1 mark. This will be the question 1. Overall, I will be very surprised if this question takes more than 10 minutes. Ordinarily, some questions you could get in about 15 to 20 seconds because you look at it and you will get it. Some questions you will have to execute, you will have to write on your rough sheet, value of I, value of sum, value of this, and go through that. It may require a minute or two. Overall, it would not require more than 10 minutes. But I will be allocating about 15 minutes for this particular question. The next 3 questions will be actual programming problems. These programming problems will revolve again around some basic programming concepts that you have studied. What I have in mind, I will write it. If you say okay, we will go ahead with it. Otherwise, we can discuss that. Question 2 will require you to write a function and its usage. This is a standard problem. If you want to solve a particular problem, you have to, sometimes you are better off writing a function. This time you will be given a problem, you will be specifically asked to write a function definition, and you will be asked to write a main program which uses that function appropriately in the context of that problem. Again, I do not expect, this may therefore have part A, part B, but these will all be short parts. I do not expect you to take more than 15 minutes to solve this problem. I would allocate anywhere between 10 minutes to 15 minutes to solve this problem. What it means is that before going to the exam, should be very clear on how to write a function definition, should be very clear on how the function is to be invoked, what are the notions of parameter passing and so on, should be very clear. Question 3 will involve a numerical problem which will require you to use arrays. It could be arrays, which could be one dimensional or two dimensional, and you will be required to do some computations that has been stated. This will be a programming problem. The problem statement itself is unlikely to be very large, but you will have to think about the right algorithm and write the program correctly. I would expect this to take anywhere between 20 to 30 minutes. So you will notice that about half the paper you should be able to complete definitely within 1 hour. Question 4 will be on character strings which have to be manipulated using arrays. There is a good question on string manipulation that I had given in the makeup quiz. Turned out to be a difficult question. I had discussed its solution. I am going to put up that solution in the Moodle today sometime. Set of slides as well as this solution. You can look at that. But you should be familiar with string manipulation. So every string which is terminated by \0 in the conventional sense, every string which has to be scanned, if you are extracting strings, how you should do it. In the discussion on the makeup quiz, I had emphasized the fact that while you can write a program ab initio, looking at all character strings independently and individually, moving characters from here to there, scanning characters, etc., etc., it is far more useful if you are familiar with the standard string library and use the standard functions. I had indicated to you that you should read the functions and their description. Many people had not done that. I would suggest that you should read those things, such as string copy. I had discussed a specific function called strtok, or the tokenizer function. You will find that function extremely useful, particularly if you have comma delimited fields and you want to extract the field values. You can do that in one shot by a small loop repeating calls to the tokenizer function. If you are not comfortable with that, you can use the conventional mechanism. But whichever way, there will be a programming problem which will need this. Question 5 and question 6. These are the two questions which will be what you call long questions. They will describe a situation. I think you are familiar with the kind of questions that I put together. I think first time you had seen the bank accounts related question, right? And then in the makeup exam, what question did I give? Makeup midsem, did I give a long question? No. Sorry? Oh, the clicker responses and so on. Yeah. The point is that in real life, there will be such situations. And as programmers, you are not expected to know the exact situation in every domain of the world. You may not know anything about banking. You may not know anything about clickers. You may not know anything about insurance. You may not know anything about any kind of message handling. SMS messages. Most of you are familiar with SMS? No? You send messages. You receive messages. Do you know how these messages are internally stored? Do you know how these messages come to you via a central hub? Do you know the disk file format in which all these messages coming from anybody and going to anybody would be stored at the hub? You don't know that. So suppose we hypothesize saying that such would be the structure and say now extract the following information. That's an important programming problem. You should be able to do that. So the question 6 and question 7 will relate to such a programming problem which will involve use of files, but it is not only about files. It is about setting a proper algorithm to extract data from those files, put them in variables and arrays if necessary, analyze that data, find out something, and then report it. So these two problems will be there of this kind. But we will stop at these two questions. It is quite likely that you may take one hour plus for these two questions. Don't think of these two questions as 30 minutes and 30 minutes. There will be a single common description for question 5 and question 6. Reading that description will take time. Please do spend 15 minutes on just reading that description and jotting it down as to what exactly you have understood. Then read the programming problems and solve them. Believe me, the actual programs will not take more than 15 minutes each to write. The character string handling program again may take about 20 to 30 minutes. This is the reason why I said that overall you should be able to finish the paper in 2.5 hours. The extra half an hour is to cross check whether you have to spend some more time somewhere. You can do that. Okay? Is this structure fine with you then? Good. There may be some tweaking in this because I have not yet discussed it with the slot 11 people. They will come in the evening and I will discuss that with them. And I will finalize this. I will put these slides on the Moodle. But for this particular lecture, while looking up, also look at slot 11 lecture. Or maybe I will put just one session 23, the consolidation of both the slots. Because this describes whatever. And it will be an open notes exam as usual. This is convocation hall exam. Last time there was a problem when we conducted the mid-sem exam in convocation hall. Several students had forgotten their I cards. Now we have a couple of faculty colleagues in our midst who will be on invigilation duty, who are very strict on these matters. I do not want any student to be inconvenienced. So please do not forget your I card when you come to the lab. Also, in spite of my repeated requests, people keep coming at the last moment. The time for the exam, do you remember? 9:30 to 12:30. 9:30 does not mean that you leave your hostels at 9:20 and rush. I would expect all students to be in place by 9:15 or at the most 9:20. It's a large class. It causes a problem in conducting the exam otherwise. And please remember 9:30 to 12:30. There's a student who came to the lab half an hour late to that exam and claimed that he thought that the exam would start at that point in time. So I had no choice but to send him to my office, give him that paper separately and put a special invigilator for him there. Please avoid such problems on my part if you can. So please come there in time. Okay, so that's all I wanted to discuss. Any other observations that you have? Then I will just use 5 minutes to give my concluding remarks and we'll close this. I must admit that in this course, I made two mistakes. One was to speed up at a point where people were just getting comfortable with the basics. And that caused a lot of problems. I'm sorry for that. Of course, that has happened. We cannot undo it. The second mistake is I did not realize the impact of Diwali this year. Believe me, in the last 40 years that I've been teaching here, I have never seen 10 days in which the campus had very little population left. Everybody had disappeared. There are some of you who tried to do some programming work for the projects, etc., from their homes. There are some I know who stayed back and did something, but it was chaotic because in a group work, a few individuals working does not make sense. It also meant that we had a huge discontinuity in our course discussion. And that is the reason why I say this is a mistake, because typically towards the end, you discuss more advanced concepts of the course, and at least those of you who are extremely interested in doing hard programming problems are deprived of an opportunity to learn some advanced concepts, for which again I am sorry. I hope this does not happen again. However, I will say this. I have seen that there are several amongst you who are really very good programmers. They not only have potential, they have actually honed their skills further. I would suggest to them that if possible, they should continue further sharpening these skills. You will have enough opportunity in your own departmental courses and elsewhere to use those programming concepts. The others who have understood programming but have not had an opportunity to solve real life problems, I'll again say the same thing. When you pass out of this course and go to the other courses in your own disciplines, do try to look for problems which require good programming skills. And you will find that you will be able to learn more from your domain and contribute significantly. There is no doubt in my mind that use of computers is only going to exponentially increase in our lives further. Are you familiar with the pace of the research and pace of development that is taking place? That pace is increasing. So we are actually accelerating. If you just consider the fantastic things that have happened in the last 20 years, which had never happened in earlier 100 years, you can imagine how many fantastic things will happen in the next 20 years. And all of you will be witnesses to that. What you have studied in this course is very preliminary, very basic. It's a first-hand exposure to the exciting world of computers. What you make of this and what you do with this is entirely dependent on you. And I think there are enough opportunities both within the institute in the remaining period of your stay as well as after you pass out. So all that I will say is all the best and thank you very much.